I'll have a different story every time I come up here. Good morning.
I said we'll split the buildings in all
but now. Yeah, what's wrong with that? It was working earlier, so I'll take it off here.
Okay.
All right, good morning, everyone. Thank you for coming this morning to hear about transit-oriented development from DESA West from Mile High Connects. Before we get started, I do want to give you a little bit of perspective of why we've invited you all here today. Hopefully many of you in the room are familiar with Southern Nevada Strong. Southern Nevada Strong is a regional planning effort that started back in 2011 when a housing and urban development grant was awarded to this region. We're very thankful to the city of Henderson, which administered that grant for about 3 years. And back in 2015, we had a regional plan that was developed and adopted by all the local jurisdictions that identified four core themes that we should be focused on in order to make our region stronger. Those four themes are to invest in complete communities, which is very much central to what we're here talking about today, to improve transportation options, which is also obviously central to transit-oriented development, to increase economic competitiveness and education, and then lastly, to build capacity for implementation of these things. And so this is kind of a capacity building event, and we thank you all for attending today. Southern Nevada Strong is an ongoing effort. It is now administered by the Regional Transportation Commission of Southern Nevada, and we have a Southern Nevada Strong team led by Ray Lathrop, who leads that effort. And so we need partners for this. Those four themes that you just heard me describe can't all be done by the RTC. And so we look to all of you in this room to help us move this effort forward. So again, thank you very much for coming today. We really appreciate your interest in this subject. We all need to get smart, I think, on transit-oriented development, and this is what this event is here to do today for us. So what I'd like to do now is bring up our general manager, Tina Quigley, to give some welcoming remarks and thank yous as well.
Yeah. It's hard not to laugh at you right now.
When
you, so Raymond just said that none of this can really happen, or that this won't happen. The RTC can't do all of the stuff that is encompassed in the Southern Nevada Strong document. The fact of the matter is that RTC really can't do any of it by itself. That's outlined in the Southern Nevada Strong document. It is our very first federally accepted regional plan. Very important. A lot of the components emphasize the importance of transit-oriented development. And yet for a lot of us who have been here in Southern Nevada for a long time, this is a fairly new concept. In fact, by raise of hand, how many of you have lived in Southern Nevada, let's say, for 10 years or more? Right? Okay, and you've worked here, right? So this is our home. So we really kind of live in our own bubble. How many of you lived here for 20 years or more? Wow, that's a lot too, right? So it's so important that as we are maturing as a region, you know, a little over 2 million, a population of 2 million, and we know we're going to continue growing, it is so important for us to kind of get outside of our bubble and to reach out to other metropolitan areas, other regions, other organizations who have been there, done that, to learn, to get their lessons learned, glean what is success, how do we move towards success, how do we partner in public sector, private sector, interagencies, etc., to really start to make some of these dreams, some of these things that are important to a healthy, vibrant community, start to happen here. So I want to say thank you for coming. This is really important. Again, RTC's role is not to implement any of this stuff. Our role is to convene all of you who are going to make this happen and make sure that we are giving you the information and the data and the speakers and the connections that you need to make this all these things that we want to see happen in Southern Nevada come true. So to that extent, I do have to say some very specific thank yous to people who have come out to attend. Tammy Graves, the director of the HUD field office. Are you, Tammy? Thank you for coming out. This is important. One of my very favorite local champions who is just tenacious at pulling things off and making conversations happen, and that is Senator Mark Menendez. Thank you so much. He is really committed to the stuff that we've got. Jocelyn Cousins, yay, thank you coming out from San Francisco, from the Federal Reserve Bank of San Francisco. Very important. She was one of our advisors as we were crafting the Southern Nevada Strong document, and she's another one that we can learn a lot from. Been there, done that. Dr. Robert Fielden, another one of my local champions from ULI. I was just telling somebody this morning that I remember he's been proselytizing, evangelizing TOD for 20 years. I remember being at the airport. I was probably just like an intern 25 years ago at the airport listening to NPR driving in. And he would be on there, right, telling all of us in Southern Nevada how we need to be focused on responsible urban planning, which included TOD development. So thank you. Mike Jansen from City of Yay and Jorge Cervantes, thanks you guys. City of Las Vegas is a very big champion. City of Henderson, thank you, Alyssa, for coming out as well. Very big champions for really trying to make this stuff come true, and I'll quit saying my thank yous, but I have one more. Ken McDonald, another champion. He says on our Southern Nevada Strong Committee, Steering Committee, so thank you. Because these are the people who, you're in this room, you guys are the people who are going to make this stuff happen. Today we're learning, but from here on out, eventually we'll get to the point where we stop learning, we actually start doing, and I look forward to that. So I'm very happy to get to introduce Deza West from Mile High Connects out of Denver. Denver is a mentor city to us. When you think about vibrant development, when you think about kind of places where you might want to live if you didn't want to live here, Denver is one of them. And Deza has been integral in getting the community to understand TOD and focusing on live-work environments. So with that, she's the executive director of Mile High Connects. I'd like to invite you to come up and share with us.
Get your PowerPoint going.
There you go. Just click forward, click back. No special tricks. All right. Hi, everyone. If this microphone isn't at the right level, just tell me. I have a little bit of trouble standing in place when I'm presenting, so just wave if I've like wandered over there and you can't hear me. Thanks so much for having me today. I'm really excited to be with you all talking about a topic that's near and dear to my heart and that's been really important for us in the city of Denver and really the whole Denver region. And that's this topic of transit-oriented development. We're going to spend a little bit of time today talking a little bit about why we think TOD is important and particularly equitable transit-oriented development, which is the part of TOD that I focus on in my work. We'll talk a little bit about some of the strategies that we've used in Denver to really move equitable TOD to be a central thing that we embrace and that we do as a community. And then we'll spend a little bit of time talking about what's also still really hard about this in the Denver region and some of the things that we're struggling with and thinking about and would love to think together with you all. And I think we'll have some time for lots of Q&A and discussion as a full group. So first I want to just talk a little bit about our moment, which for Denver was really a voter-approved tax measure back in 2004 that gave us the opportunity to build an enormous, enormous light rail system. At the time, it was the biggest public investment in a rail system, $7.8 billion, 122 miles of rail and bus rapid transit, 77 stations. And so as we looked at that, we knew that there was going to be this opportunity for this to be something that would transform the face of our region. And we could either grab that opportunity and make it something that transformed our region in a way that really benefited community, or we could let that happen and we could miss this opportunity. And so for us, we said, you know, we transit-oriented development itself comes with all kinds of benefits, right? It has the opportunity to reduce congestion, to improve air quality if people are using transit in different ways. You can create these walkable neighborhoods that help facilitate health. You can think about services and amenities in these communities, and it has the opportunity to really create lots of economic development and vibrancy. But what we also know from looking nationally is that unless you're being really very thoughtful about how you're communicating and engaging community, how you're thinking about the ways that resources are leveraged across sectors, and how you're thinking about the policy environment that's around these places, you miss the opportunity to really support all community members. And in particular, low-income communities and communities of color often get left behind. And so that was really the impetus for forming my organization, Mile High Connects. Malahide Connects really came together initially around the idea of housing and transportation. What we know is that those two items are often the two biggest costs in a family's budget. And so our kind of founding principle was, well, if we think about affordable housing and we plunk it down next to transit, which is oftentimes a more affordable form of transportation, we'll have done something really awesome for the community. And so that was really where our work began. As we started to become more sophisticated, what we saw was there's lots more to it than that, right? Just having housing and transit next to each other isn't the thing that transforms communities. You have to really be thinking about place as a whole. What are the educational opportunities? Where is the job training? How are you creating good jobs in the commercial space that's being developed? How are you making sure that you're understanding the assets in the community and that you're leveraging those development opportunities to bring things into the community that may have been lacking before, whether that's fresh food or job training or educational opportunities? And so that's really the direction that Mile High Connects has pursued over the 6 years that we've been together. Our partnership is really a cross-sector partnership. It's a group of nonprofits, foundations, banks, other private sector players, and a lot of public sector partners really all working together on those areas of policy, community engagement, and resourcing. The other piece of our work that I'm not going to spend as much time talking about in this presentation, but I think is the really important other half to our work, is that what we know is that not all people in the Denver region live within a half a mile of one of these light rail stations that we're focused on the development. And so we also step back and are looking at the full network of our transit system. So we're looking at our bus system and our rail system together, and really trying to make sure that transit is accessible so that it can be a way that helps to solve some of the transportation challenges that people have, regardless of whether they live near rail. And so that part of our work really looks like thinking about the affordability of bus and light rail fares. It's something that we've heard from community that is not affordable to lowest income riders. Bus service routes, how do they work with our rail system, and how do we make sure that they're going to communities that need them and taking those communities to good jobs and healthy food and quality schools? And what kind of infrastructure is in place in all of our places to get people actually from their house to a transit stop and a transit stop to their final place of their final destination? What kinds of things need to go on with sidewalks and drainage and lighting and those kinds of things? So that's the other part and the other side of our TOD focus. I think the thing that I would say to you kind of over and above almost anything else is that really reaching out and engaging community in all ways is a really important part of building a culture of support for TOD. When Mile High Connects came together, they put together a strategic plan that was kind of like all good things for people everywhere. And when I came to the collaborative about 3 years ago, what I really understood was that first 3 years of time together was really just doing what we're doing in the audience here together today, which was having us all understand that there are these real ripe opportunities when you have an investment in some infrastructure, whether that's rail, whether that's really thinking about high-frequency bus, that we really need to build a common platform and a common understanding, and that needs to come across your community, like with community residents, with nonprofit organizations, with your university partners, with your business partners, with your public sector partners. No single entity is able to carry and do this on their own, and there are different right roles for all of those entities. And so when Tina talks about really everybody kind of stepping into the space and really making it happen together, that's absolutely critical for implementation, doing it in partnership with community and with other stakeholders. So I'm going to talk a little bit about our approach and the ways that we started to build support and the kind of intentional steps and paths that we took to get to where we are today. And so the things that I'll talk about are data, about engaging community, about some of the policy and implementation pieces that we're working on. So data was really where we started. We felt like to really know what we were trying to solve, we needed to understand the region. And so the very first thing that we did as a partnership was create something that's called the Denver Regional Equity Atlas. When it first came out, it was in a hard copy version, and what it really showed was just basic maps that said, here's where our transit is, here's where our future transit's going, here's where our affordable housing is right now, here's where good jobs are, Here's where the quality schools are. How do these overlay with each other? And as we're planning and as we're thinking together, are we making a difference? And are we making choices that the data tells us are good choices for people? And what it showed was that there were huge mismatches. That affordable housing would be in one location, that jobs would be in another location, and that our transit lines were not necessarily connecting those dots. And so it really gave us a sense of where we needed to focus our development efforts, both to make sure jobs were in places where housing was, and that housing was in places that jobs were. And you could think about it from that same angle from services. We also then had the opportunity through the Sustainable Communities Initiative that was mentioned earlier to partner with our MPO to actually take that and put it online and make it into an interactive tool. It's something that you can go on our website, that you can go on our MPO's website and access. And it gives you the opportunity to do that in real time interactively. So you could drill down into a neighborhood or a particular place. And that's given our partners the opportunity to really both make their own decisions based on that data, as well as to do case making about what needs there are. And it starts to show us over time how things are changing for us as a region. Through that same grant, we were able to do a fair housing equity assessment. We were able to do a regional housing study. It really gave us a picture of where the housing gaps and needs were. And mostly it just told us, we need a lot more housing. We need a lot more affordable housing, and we kind of need it everywhere. But that it, for the most part, was concentrated in Denver. And then the newest tool that we've started to use as we think about housing and transit is something that we call our opportunity tool. And what it has done is kind of aggregated sets of indicators around education, around health, around a whole, you know, maybe five different factors. And it really looks at the communities that we're putting our affordable housing in. Are we putting housing in communities where there are low quality schools and no health supports? If so, do we really want to make that investment? Do we see that investment as an economic development spur? Or do we need to look for another site and another location? That tool is not online, but if folks are interested in that tool, I know that we would be really happy to share it. So data was really important to us for case making. We had folks like this convening. We had Manuel Pastor come out and talk to us and help us understand what we needed to do. And that really got folks excited and interested. And they said, well, if we have this data, how do we start to play with it? And how do we start to use it in some of our planning processes? And planning is something that was really important for us to do, not just in a station area by station area way, but to do really across a whole continuum. So what you're seeing up here is the West Corridor, which was the first of the rail lines that opened in this little period of rail lines opening, so back in 2012. And that was a really interesting experiment for us to think about it as a corridor, because it crossed two local jurisdictions, and it crossed two local housing authorities, and it crossed folks that didn't necessarily come together to plan. And so the communities came together, community residents, as well as the cities and the housing authorities, and really started to think about this corridor as one entity. And what they said is not every single place needs to have a mixed income housing and commercial space and a food bank and, right, not every place needs to have that, but we need to have something along this corridor that allows people to work, that allows people to play, that allows people to recreate, that allows people to be educated. And so really started to draw out from the sites and the parcels that we have around this rail line, how do we assemble these in a way, and how do we use what we have assembled to really meet the needs of our community residents and the things that they're telling us. The other thing that happened in this planning process, and that's something that we've replicated in each of our corridors, was really doing a pretty deep assessment of what assets already existed in those communities, so that you knew if there was a hospital along the rail line, probably health isn't the thing that you're going to need to focus on. And so it really helped to guide and help to understand the development patterns. And lots of nuance under that, right? I mean, it's not easy for municipalities or for anyone, right, to kind of give up control. And so it was a really interesting experiment to look at how you lean in and trust each other across jurisdictions to be able to create something that really is focused on place and not focused on local boundaries. And what that ended up giving us was some really concrete detail and information. So you can see that at each of the stops along the West Line, there's an opportunity to say, you know, we think we could get about this much square footage of commercial space. We think we could get about this many units of housing. We think about affordable housing. And this is a plan that's been a huge guiding document since 2012, and much of it has been implemented. We're especially seeing real success in the affordable housing and the mixed income housing along this particular corridor. And we're seeing our other corridors starting to move in similar ways. I do want to go back to this question of community engagement. I think it's one that I think it's the other side of that coin of data. I think sometimes we think of data as being maps and kind of quantifiable square footage types of things, but community engagement is really data too, and it's really important data, and I would argue maybe even more important data than the other forms of data collection, because it's really the people in the places that you're impacting telling you what they need. And the more that we're able to listen, the more that we're able to be in those community spaces together with folks in a really genuine way, the better job we're going to do in making sure that the things that we build are the things that people are going to use, and they're the things that are going to support people in achieving the kind of quality of life that they're looking towards. We spend a lot of time both out in the community itself, being places where people are, talking with them. We also spend a lot of time funding small little neighborhood groups to do that work themselves so that they can talk to us, so that they can tell us, so that they have their own safe space to really collectively talk about what they want their neighborhoods to look like, and then they have some language to really talk with the planners and developers who are in that community. It's not easy work, it's not quick work, and I think that's why sometimes we miss this step, or we hold a community meeting and if 20 people show up and we call that community engagement. It's something that really needs to be built into process, and that you find some really surprising things sometimes. Sometimes community doesn't necessarily want the things that your map tells you that they might want. The third thing that we did was really start to think about how we could be creative with resources. I'll say Denver is a pretty policy-light environment. We've got a little bit of a Wild West feel. We don't really want to put a lot of rules on ourselves. And so a lot of the time, we'll enter into something through almost a demonstration project, and then we'll have the policy follow along. And that's really what we did here in our TOD work with the creation of what was originally called the Denver Transit-Oriented Development Fund. It's now a regional fund, so regional is in the name as well. But we didn't really have any source of funding for affordable housing. Our city was only, and the city of Denver was only funding affordable housing through federal dollars, which were shrinking. And we didn't have any other mechanisms or resources. And so we had to start to think creatively about where those could come from. So I was working for the city at the time. We found kind of a pot of some dollars that were about doing kind of green development. And we started talking with some partners, some philanthropic partners and some banks to say, well, what would it look like if we could put some of that in at no cost, right? Some very low cost capital, and we'll absorb the highest risk. Can we put together some stacked funding that would then allow us to create a resource that would give us the opportunity to build or preserve affordable housing near transit? So it was quite a process to assemble. This was the first TOD fund in the nation that had a 10-year time horizon. Since then, there have been a number that have been created. The Bay Area has one that's like 18 times the size of ours, because they always can do things 18 times the size of what we do. Seattle just did one. It was the first thing they were behind us on. But this resource was really important because what it allowed us to do was to buy land in areas that we knew that transit was going to be before those land values really went up, and to be able to hold on to that land and either preserve the affordability of properties that were on the land, or to do land banking, and then to actually build new affordable housing that we would never have been able to afford if we were trying to buy it right now. It was also really the only development that was happening in 2010 and 2011 as we were kind of starting to come out of the recession. And so it was really interesting timing for us, because that was the only development activity that you were seeing. And so it really gave us this important opportunity to highlight what TOD could be. It brought city partners to the table in some different ways. It helped some of the private sector developers understand that affordable housing could be something that actually generated cash and revenue and was a viable thing to do. And it gave us the opportunity to work with this whole range of partners who hadn't been thinking about community development previously and who are now part of seeing some really beautiful things come out of the ground. And we've continued to work with those partners to do more and more each year. This last September, we just had a really phenomenal, what I would call win for the community, in that we created a $150 million dedicated affordable housing fund that'll come together over the next 10 years in the city of Denver. This is the first fund of its kind in Colorado, and is a big deal to go from the city investing $0 in affordable housing in 2007 to investing $150 million in 2017. So, big progress there, but lots of work getting people comfortable and helping people understand how affordable housing finance works, right? And how those pieces come together. I would say that our biggest focus right now is really on policy itself. So we've demonstrated that TOD works, but we have some things that are getting in the way. And we're growing up as a city. We need some different kinds of policies that are in place. For us, we're a very, as I said, policy-light environment, and that means that we don't put a lot of restrictions on developers and we don't require a lot of things in return for being able to get city dollars to build. So there are all kinds of things that we're looking at to help support both getting more resources into development, helping people really think about development in a full way, so that people are using their retail and their commercial space in a way that benefits community and isn't just kind of the earliest and easiest thing. We don't need Chipotle's at every single rail stop, right? We might need some other things. We're exploring ideas of land ownership, community land ownership, and doing a lot of work around renter protections. There's some pieces that make it hard, even if we're putting the units near transit, for people to actually stay in those units. And so that's a really big piece of the work that we're up to today and will continue to be in. I wanted to just highlight that something that we're really focused on in this work is around mixed income developments. I don't think anyone wants to see development where there's, this is where all of the affordable housing is, and this is where all of the workforce housing is, and this is where all of the high-end housing is. We're really focused on how you weave resources together to be able to get at that in a more of a complete community. And so these are some examples of some of our mixed income developments. And you can see they're beautiful buildings. In most, I think, all of these pictures, they're a third market rate, a third workforce housing, so about 60% area median income, and then a third public housing and Section 8 vouchers. The units are exactly the same, and they're full because Denver is in a housing crunch. What we've seen is that we can do that most successfully through our housing authority because they have some resources and they're an awesome developer. We are seeing some of our other developer partners put a few units of affordable housing into market rate or building a whole set of buildings, and they'll have one building that comes out as an affordable, one building that comes out as a workforce, and one that comes out as a market. So we're still playing with that. I think that's something that we're still working through. I'd be curious to hear about experiences that you all have. But I think for us, what we know is that the more that we can integrate our communities, the more that we're able to see really successful outcomes in those communities themselves. And just some more pictures of things. I do want to talk a little bit, though, about some of the challenges that we're facing in the Denver area. I think we've been able to do a lot. We've been able to create over 1,200 units of affordable housing near transit over the last 4 years. We've been able to pass legislation around affordable housing preservation. We've been able to create over 300,000 feet of commercial space that has community-serving businesses in it. We've been able to employ over 200 people through job training programs that we've supported in those transit areas. But there's also really huge things that are happening around us, which are that there are major public investments going in even beyond rail, and those places are quickly gentrifying and displacing people as well, so that policy context is really important. We have a huge influx of growth into our city, both millennials and older adults and seniors coming into our community because it's a great place to live and because we're creating all this TOD. And so it's this really nice way for people to be able to, who value public transit to be able to live near transit and work near transit and take transit. We're also seeing that our wage growth is not keeping up with our rising housing costs. And so you're seeing wage growth at about 2%, rising housing costs at about 22%. And so there's a real differential and a real squeeze that's coming from an affordable housing perspective. These charts are ones that I use and just tell folks in Denver, like, if you don't know these charts, it's you maybe just got dropped here by, you know, from outer space, because we're just seeing such high spikes in our housing market, in both the rental and the home ownership market. And we just don't actually have enough housing is part of it. We're about 80,000 units short of what we would need to have just in the affordable housing space. And we don't have enough housing at any place along the continuum. So much of our focus over this period of time is really on both how do we build new, but also how do we preserve and make sure that we're not losing the housing stock that we have near these transit sites, so that we're able to, so that we're not kind of digging ourselves more and more deeply into a hole. And that's important because we know that housing is really, stable housing, and stable housing, particularly in TOD, can be a foundation for intersecting in all kinds of other ways. That when kids are in stable housing and they're able to move about their community, they're more likely to be able to make it to school on time and to be able to make it to school regularly. Their parents are more likely to be able to get to employment opportunities and more likely to be able to do that regularly. And that communities really build and can convene around these kinds of really important developments. So I'm going to stop there, and let's have a little bit of conversation. What's
Say a few words real quick?
Please, say some words.
Sorry, I'm a glory hog. I like to come up here and kick the speaker away. And what we wanted to do, though, before we get into questions and answers, we do have a couple sponsors today that we really want to give an opportunity to come up and say a few words. These are partners that we think are really critical to this conversation moving forward because of the space that they currently occupy. And then I also have a homework assignment for everyone as well that I want you to think about before we move into the question and answer, and that is, at the end of today's discussion, what we want to do is we're going to pass out some sunbeams. For those of you that came to our annual summit back in September, you might be familiar with this exercise. The question that I'm going to pose to you is, what are the things that we should be focused on as a region here in Southern Nevada Strong to advance transit-oriented development? And so you heard a lot of important themes today from DESA, you know, things about equity, things about policy, things about financing and funding, things about data. What I'd like to do is hear from all of you about what are the things we as Southern Nevada Strong team and what partners we should be engaging in this space. So put your thinking caps on, both in terms of the questions you'd like to ask DESA for follow-up, as well as the things that we need to be focused on as a region. So first, who I'd like to bring up is Mike Mullen from Nevada Hand. If you're not familiar with them, they're doing fabulous work, especially for affordable housing here in the Valley. We thought they were a logical partner because of this idea of equitable transit-oriented development and then the clients that Hand serves. So, Mr. Mullen, thank you.
Thanks.
Hi. I want to thank Southern Nevada Strong, Tina, and RTC for having us here, and basically just want to briefly introduce myself. I'm Mike Mullen. I'm the founder of Nevada Hand, and Nevada Hand is the largest provider of affordable housing in Nevada. We have about 30 communities around the valley. We have about 3,500 units. We have 700 units under construction right now, and we house about 5,500 folks in families and seniors, and so transportation is integral to affordable housing because families have to get to work, to get to school, often have one car, and just to be able to show up. And for seniors with limited ways to get around, it's critical for them also to get just to the groceries and get around. So I think we've heard talk about mixed income housing. There's really not a lot of mixed income housing or mid-rise type apartments in Las Vegas. We're kind of flattened out or giant high rises. So I think there's really an opportunity to, and we would like to figure out how to do more mixed income housing and would love to find partners that are interested in doing that. And for us, with partnering with the private sector, little shameless plug for us is that I think we can, we understand the federal regulations, we understand the affordable housing regulations, we understand the, you know, how to put that piece of it together. And I think the ideal partnership is that, you know, we can help figure out the affordable piece, we have a private sector piece, and we know how to steward the funds and actually be the, how do I want to say this, the regulation BS filter. So we know how to make sure for the private sector that that you're in compliance with all the regulations, and so we know how to weave our way through that. So it's kind of a plug for us, looking for developer partners that would like to try to figure out how to put some mixed income housing around transit-oriented development in some of our downtowns that are looking for it, or out in the suburbs. So thank you again for having us here and allowing me that time. Thanks.
Thank you, Mike. If we see regulation BS filter on one of those sunbeams, we know where that came from. Another exciting partner that I'd like to bring up is Benoit Jacob from UNLV. This is a brand new program that just started at UNLV that we think will be a really strong partner for us in the future. And I'll let him tell you all about it. So Benoit, if you wouldn't mind coming on up.
Well, I'd like to also echo my thanks to the RTC and to Southern Nevada Strong for having us here. This is, I think, a tremendous event, and I do also want to say, so the, a little small world connection, so I came to UNLV from the University of Colorado in Denver, and so I've had opportunities to work with DESA and see DESA present at several panels. And before doing anything, I want to say, if you don't realize it already, what a tremendous opportunity you've just had. DESA is one of the national leaders, I think, in this area, and is tremendously smart, and is really just a wonderful person. And so I would like to just offer, she got rushed off stage, I'd like to give her just a round of applause, because I think she did a wonderful job. And I think, from what I understand, you all have her working very hard over this next 12 hours or so. So do take, I would take full advantage, because she is just, I think, a wonderful resource in this space. I do want to tell you briefly about, so I came from the University of Colorado, where I was the director of the local government center there. And I've been tasked here with starting up a program on urban leadership. And this is a super exciting program for the university and a super exciting opportunity for me, just because of the space that cities and communities are in today, right? I mean, when you thought about cities and communities 10, 15 years ago, they were kind of this administrative arm, they were the lowest level of government, they were kind of this area that took care of the nitty-gritty. They fixed potholes, maybe they had small community events, this sort of thing. Communities and cities and neighborhoods today are far different, just over the last 10 years. Cities and communities now are on the forefront of all the major policy issues. When you talk about immigration reform, you talk about transportation, you talk about gun control, it is cities and communities that are going to shape this. And so this is an exciting time, and we're excited to be working on this program, because when cities and communities are moving into this new area, we think that it dictates and demands a new type of leader. So urban leaders and community leaders today are very different than the urban leaders of 5-10 years ago. And so we have a program where we're a part of which is a master's degree in urban leadership. It's actually the first program of its type in the country. The second program will in the country will start up in the fall of 2017 at Harvard, so we're excited to sort of be beating them out of the gate. And at the same time, we feel like we're in good company. As I told my dean when we started, when we found out that Harvard was also starting the exact same program, I said, look, I've been here for 5 months, and already we have the number two program in the country, only behind Harvard. So I'm very excited to be a part of that. But let me just, I'm an academic professor, and so I can't help myself. So let me just give you a brief little motivation of theory, and then I'll sort of conclude with one last shameless plug. But in this world of community engagement and community and development and urban planning and so forth, there's an interesting paradox. We call it the paradox of diversity. There's no good reason for anyone to have heard of this, but there is this thing that we have, a dilemma when you go down the route of diversity. We love diversity, right? Communities, we talk about this all the time, right? Communities that are more vibrant, more resilient, are going to be these communities that are diverse. And so we want to find ways to foster diversity wherever we can. Fair? Right? People, I imagine that's a shared value, maybe. But at the same time, diversity poses a problem. The more people you get in a community that don't look alike, there tends to be more tension. There tends to be more conflict. There tends to be more difficulty in getting groups that are not alike around the same table to talk about important things. And so while we want to encourage diversity, it poses this paradox of how do you do it because of the tensions that underlie it. And how you do that is exactly how DESA, which is why, first of all, I never ever like to speak behind someone like DESA because it just pales in comparison, and she's always going to beat you to the punch. But the key here is, of course, community engagement. And so one of the things we want to do at our program, which is why we were so excited to sort of sponsor this event, is we want to help facilitate a series of critical conversations. And one of the most critical conversations you can have, I think, in a community and cities at this time and place is around the role of transit and around the role of affordable housing. These two things are integral for creating diverse, resilient communities. And so I'm very excited that this event has occurred. I'm excited that we can be a part of it. And my shameless plug, I was told I was given like 5 minutes. I'm sure I've already exceeded that. I said it was impossible. Couldn't be done anyway, so it was a ridiculous goal. But we're excited to be a part of this event and excited to start fostering and helping support as many critical conversations as we can. This, of course, is one of them. We are holding a panel discussion. I invite you all to it this upcoming Saturday, a week from this Saturday, February 4th, at Greenspun College of Urban Affairs. It's a panel on transitional housing and homelessness, and I think it's a great opportunity to sort of continue the conversation you all are having here. So I invite you all to this, and thank you all for the opportunity, and thank you again to DESA for, I think, a wonderful job.
All right.
Anyway, let's give one more round of applause to Mike and Benoit, not only because of they gave us some extra food for thought to complement what Jason was saying, but because they helped put a pull off today's event. They were sponsors today, and they couldn't have done it without their assistance. So please, one
more round.
All right, so what we'd like to do now, you've had a few minutes to kind of stew over everything you've heard. And so what we'd like to do is open it up for questions and answers. One thing that I do ask is that you project as loudly as possible. This is the only mic we have at the moment. We are recording this. Dace, if I could ask a favor of you, if you could just kind of paraphrase the question back through the speakers just so we can capture that. So let's open it up. I have a couple leading questions, so maybe I'll start off since I'm here. So my first question is, in hindsight's always 2020, right? In retrospect, if you had a chance to do it all over again, maybe from your perspective at Mile High Connects or even just as a community of Denver, what were some of those lessons learned? What would have you done differently to maybe chart a path? What are some of the missteps that maybe you could have avoided that maybe we can avoid since we're just kind of embarking on this journey now?
Can I share the mic? I think for me that the theme of starting early is so resonant because we didn't start early enough. I think the moment that we started really thinking about putting this massive amount of rail into the ground was the right time for us to start thinking about the land use issues and the community development issues that would come along with it. I think what we saw was that we thought a little bit early, right? We put the TOD fund together and were able to buy land a little before the rail went into the ground. But as jurisdictions, we need to be doing that planning a lot earlier. And it's hard to do, right? Because people get excited about it when it's right there on top of them. But that's not the right time to do the planning. So similarly, we're facing this affordable housing challenge as a region right now. We were having conversations 5 years ago with jurisdictions to say these housing pressures are going to come to your place as rail comes to your place. And jurisdictions would say to us, no, this has always been market rate affordable. It's always just by virtue of the housing stock and where it is, always going to be affordable. And what we're now seeing is essentially 0% vacancy, not just in Denver itself, but in our inner ring suburbs. Had we thought in advance and put some of the policy things that we're trying to do now in place, we would be much better off. So it's something that I think is so exciting about the conversation that you're having here, is that you're thinking about these really fundamental things now, right, as the stuff is starting to percolate, and that's just the right time. I think the other thing I might do differently, just from a Mile High Connects perspective, it took us a little while, I think, to really get into this kind of yin and yang around the data that community gives you and the data that comes through through other more traditional sources. And our table, I didn't talk a lot about how it's constructed, but it is this kind of weird, tense table that Benoit was referring to, where we have community organizers sitting with bankers making governance decisions together. And sometimes those organizers are also protesting those banks about other things, right? And so that tension of where does community voice fit versus data that's kind of the more traditional data is something that I think we should have spent some more time wrestling with at the beginning, because I think we would have started some of our really deep work in community differently. Yeah. Yeah.
The strategies you guys used to create your foundation for the land banking, essentially, what were some of those early conversations that were being had? Because that's obviously one of those things that we need to be moving towards, particularly as we're looking at our first line potentially in the near term, is safeguarding some of those lands available for future development.
Yeah, that's great. So the question was, what were some of the conversations and thinking that we were doing when we were creating the Transit-Oriented Development Fund and thinking about land banking? So there were a couple of pieces of conversation that were happening. One was just this conversation about land banking in general. I think our ideal kind of thinking about it initially was maybe that cities would just buy up the land that they had, or they would say the land that they had in those places could be used for these kind of community-serving purposes. And what we found is that there was not a huge amount of appetite for land banking in our jurisdictions at that time. And so we really needed to go get a little bit more creative and get a little bit more complicated where the conversation went from there. What we could get into place was the city of Denver agreeing to take that risk position as we put those tranches of capital together. And then it took a long time actually to get our foundation community to come in with some investment capital as well. They weren't used to thinking about it in this way. They hadn't seen it done before. Impact investing wasn't as big a thing at that time. Now everybody's like, oh, well, of course we'll invest in the TOD fund. That's very safe. It's wonderful. It's working, right? But at the time, nobody had seen it. So it was a lot of really in-depth and detailed conversations trying to get people comfortable with the idea that you could do land banking and that this tool could be used. Now, the TOD fund can't be used 100% for vacant land. We have to have properties in it that generate some revenue, right, to be able to cover the holding costs of the land. And so there were also a lot of conversations about, well, what's the right balance? Do we put a top-end restriction on vacant land versus land that has revenue-generating properties on it? I think we landed at 25% of the original fund. It's a little bit larger now, but not much. So it's not solely for land banking. And then we spent a lot of time talking with other national communities who were looking at doing the same thing. And there's hesitancy around land banking. So and it's an interesting conversation for folks to wrestle with. Yeah.
So I've been fortunate to live and grow up to a certain extent in Denver, Colorado. So seen the transformation over my life. Nevada is not a home rule state, whereas Colorado is. Mm-hmm. When it came to the policy discussion, what types of housing and land use policies were contemplated and enacted at the state level and maybe at the local level?
So he was saying he's from Denver. He has lived in Denver at various points. and that there's some differences in that Denver's a home rule state, which gives local jurisdictions a different kind of power. And was wondering from a policy perspective what was happening at a state level versus a local level. I would say for us over the last 4 years, we've had essentially a completely stuck state legislature, particularly around housing issues, so not a lot has happened in a policy construct of the state. We've been running various revenue bills to try to get an affordable housing fund at a statewide level for many years with lots of different mechanisms, and that hasn't worked. We've been trying to get some of the renter and tenant protections into place. There are lots of things at our state level that get in the way of that, so trying to peel those back. And so I would say really at a state level, hardly anything has happened in the housing space over the course of this last 4 years. We've been very, very, very focused for that reason on our local jurisdictions. And so we're seeing lots of small movement, but important movement that's supporting both from a funding perspective and then again from kind of a protection of people perspective at that local and regional level. And some of that is made possible by the fact that we are a home rule state. We also have lots of other kind of interesting things in place that make our state work hard. So we have something called TABOR, which makes makes it really impossible for us to actually generate revenue without going to a vote of the people, and it requires us to return revenues that we take in back to the people if they hit at a certain level. So there's some things in our state that make it a little complicated to do things at that statewide level. Yeah.
Yeah, on your land making process, were you able to use eminent domain for that, or did you negotiate purchase of the property?
We did not use eminent domain. We negotiated purchases of the property. Part of that is that the way that particular fund structure works is that we have a national CDFI that administers the fund, Enterprise Community Partners. And for the first few years of the fund, we actually had a sole borrower called the Urban Land Conservancy. They're a nonprofit housing developer. It sounds actually really similar to some of what Nevada Hand does here. To kind of prove the concept, so they wouldn't have had power of eminent domain, so they were having to negotiate that purchase price. Now it's opened up. The borrowers can be any, and you know, we've had housing authorities and private sector development, you know, all kinds of folks borrowing against it, but try really hard to stay away from eminent domain. That's a complicated space to be in, and not one that we wanted to be in kind of right out of the gate as we promoted TOD. Yeah, and then
Agriculture is a big growing movement in development, and I know.
Can you say the first word?
Sorry, agriculture is a big trend and growing trend in development. In terms of mixed use agricultural, you know, urban farming, and given that Denver's got a very large and very active green movement, I'm curious about how you've integrated that concept in your value added housing. In particular, there's a movement in vertical growing in multi-unit housing. Mm-hmm. And I'm really curious about how that is looked at in Denver as a model for here in the desert.
That's great. So the question was about how urban agriculture and affordable housing fit together as we think about TOD. I would say in a couple of ways. I can't think of any of the developments that we have that are actually an urban farm, but I think most of the developments that we have community gardens in them. And so there's, you know, kind of smaller scale agriculture that's happening. We do have some just straight TOD, not with an equity perspective, that have done some really interesting things on the rooftops of their buildings in terms of both greenhouses and then some other growing opportunities. And then there's actually a really wonderful and interesting project out to the east of Denver that's really focused on community gardens, but through a cultural lens. That's an area where there are a huge number of different of refugees and asylees from many different countries. And so it's a really cool project that that's really not just, you know, about growing food, but about growing food that then really fits with people's cultures. So it's definitely a piece of the conversation, and it's definitely a land use that we're seeing. The other thing that we're seeing is if we're holding land that's a good interim use before any vertical development goes up. Great question. Yeah.
A couple questions on financing mechanisms. So on the foundation, is that totally philanthropy, or is there some other sort of funding mechanism that supports that? And then on the larger physical housing, affordable housing development, do you have any innovative types of financing that you use to do the affordable piece, like the voucher piece? Is that, is the housing authority taking Section 8 and project-basing those? Or?
Yeah, great question. So if I'm understanding your question right, there's two questions. One is, what role does the foundation community play both in funding the work that we're doing as well as funding the actual affordable housing itself? And then what are the other tools and mechanisms from a financing perspective that we use? So I would say for philanthropy, we have some just straight grants from philanthropy that come to Mile High Connects that we then distribute out to partners in the ways I was describing for some of the community engagement and some of the policy work. So that's one thing that brings those unusual partners to the table to work together, is that there's some resource that helps them be at the table together. They also invest in a couple of financing tools. I highlighted the TOD fund here. That's what's called program-related investment capital. So it's low cost payback, but it's still payback. It's not just a straight grant. And increasingly, we're seeing them use larger parts of their endowments to fund and think about kind of what purchase of real estate looks like there as well. For that, from the housing authority perspective, our housing authorities are very much using project-based vouchers and porting vouchers between places in the region where they know that really important critical projects are. So our Denver Housing Authority works closely with our Aurora Housing Authority and our Adams County Housing Authority and our Lakewood Housing Authority. And so, you know, there's almost this pooled system. In some cases, that's to deal with the limited number of landlords who will accept vouchers in Denver because the market rate is so high. But in some cases, it's an ability to really get jobs done, particularly in the spaces of supportive service housing, so that, you know, kind of very lowest income housing. We're seeing a lot of project basing in that space. And then the other thing that we've been working on, and this is much newer for us, is really looking at impact investing beyond the foundation community. So it's this idea that there are individuals of wealth who invest in things, and they invest in real estate not thinking about social impact. But they also are really interested in thinking about concessionary returns, where they would invest some, expect dollars back, would expect some real return, but that return could be slightly lower because there's also a social benefit. So we've been working with a group of, I think it's all men, a group of about 20 men who are high net worth guys, to help understand how do we get those dollars to start to flow into this space. And we think there's some real possibility there. What they've been telling us is that they don't really care that deeply about what the impact is. Like, they want to know that there's a good solid manager of the money, and they want to just trust us that the impact is going to be good. I think they say, like, we'll squint. If we squint and it looks good, we're fine with that. Like, we're interested in the return, and we want there to be some impact. And so what that does for us is it gives us the opportunity to take some of these siloed funds that we have. We have a fresh food financing fund that looks kind of like the TOD fund, and we have a couple of like very structured funds for specific purposes that people are having to kind of try to weave together. And we think this is a kind of capital that can amplify that because it's much bigger dollars and can weave between those single purpose funds because there's just less investor pressure to have one particular kind of outcome. So we're hoping to have that platform closed by the end of the year, and we think that that'll bring in a substantive amount of many millions more dollars into our community development work.
You have mentioned early on about community ownership land. Has that evolved into a productive means of getting mixed income housing into certain areas, and how does that work?
Yeah, it's a great question. Denver has been really slow to come to the community, the Denver region has been really slow to come to the community land trust movement. You know, we see a lot more of that happening in the south and up in the northeast, a little bit on the west coast. I think we have two community land trusts in the metro area that were created long before this current set of strategies that are happening. So what we're seeing right now is that we're seeing interest from community. We're needing to do a lot of capacity building with community to be ready to be owners of the land, and that we're doing financial feasibility studies. So those two things are coming together. We have three places that are really actively exploring that, just in the perspective of neighborhoods themselves. And we're working with some developer partners who are buying houses. You know, owners are putting their houses up for sale, particularly owners that don't live in the neighborhoods now, because they can get good dollars for them. And so we're trying as much as possible to get our mission-driven developers to buy those so that they can hold them, so that when the community is ready, we can put them into a land trust. The other piece that's really happening around community ownership, and this one's really complicated, is our manufactured housing, our mobile home parks, which are in many cases right near rail, right? If you think of it from a planner perspective, it's not the highest and best use. You want density, but there's also 100 families living there and there's no vacancy anywhere, right? And so in some of those cases, what we're seeing is those groups are forming homeowners associations and working to actually buy the parks themselves. We had one that's very, very close in the city of Aurora. And so it's an interesting time to think about community ownership, because the time when you actually would want to buy is when the market's low, right? Like that would have been, thinking early, right? That would have been the best time for us to buy the land.
Well, I was thinking there. About the Green Bay model, where the Green Bay, the town owns Green Bay Packers and the stadium things. And I'm wondering about if there was any of this kind of movement going on where communities are purchasing properties and then leasing them back over the long term to developers in order to stimulate cash flow and get their return on their investment, but yet make it truly affordable for the developer to get the developer's return on the investment.
Yeah, we haven't seen that. We haven't seen that happen in Denver. One other thing that we're in that we're working on right now is working with anchor institutions, so hospitals, universities, local school districts, local governments, around whether they might deed land that they're not going to use, or they're not using, or that they don't want over for some community purpose, and let the community then do some kinds of things, not exactly what you're describing, but it's another thing we're kicking around that's still too early to say, like, is that going to have any legs yet? Yeah.
How aggressive were you able to get with reducing parking requirements on TOD developments, and did the city and county of Denver have to step up and provide sort of shared parking, public structures, so that the developer's cost for implementing the TOD was kept to a point where it could be successful? What we hear often is that many banks won't fund some of the investments if you don't have parking, and so it's sort of like that, you know, chicken and egg. You want that development, you want people to use transit, but yet the banks want you to put in parking. And I think a lot of communities struggle with that, so I'd be curious how you guys.
Yeah, great. The question was, what's up with parking? And I will just say, this is the conversation that comes up every time you talk about TOD, right? Like, why can't we reduce the parking requirements? Because if we could, then the cost would come down exponentially, and we could absolutely do so much affordable housing. Denver's had a couple, I want to say two places that they're experimenting with less parking. But it's places where they're doing micro units, and so that's been the only place that we've seen them ready to give. The huge advocacy from the development community and from transit, biking, and walking advocates, right? I mean, I have lots and lots and lots and lots and lots and lots of conversation about parking, but we haven't seen the city really willing to move on that very much, which I don't think it's a conversation that's going away. I think some of what, I think some of the pressure on the other side is neighbors next to those developments not wanting more parking on the street, right? They're worried about that kind of congestion. It's a little bit of chicken and egg, right? Like if you have parking, then people will have cars, and if you don't have parking, right? I mean, it keeps reinforcing itself. Our transit ridership isn't huge in Denver. And, you know, I mean, we talk about all of this TOD, and the piece of this that we're not talking about is, you know, how we make sure that people are getting on transit and that transit's
really the mode that that's helping them to get there. And so I think that's a conversation that's very live and very active and still pretty far from being resolved in our place. And a lot of places that I look around the country too, I feel like parking is like the thing that none of us can quite figure out. Yeah, in the back.
Asa, could you tell us how you got your cross-sector partnerships going and some of the key strategies for doing something like that here?
Sure. So the question was, how do we form some of the cross-sector partnerships that we put together? We started pretty slow and pretty intimate. So when we first came together, it was five nonprofit partners, I want to say five or six foundation partners and three banking partners. We had worked together to create this transit-oriented development fund before Mile High Connects was a thing. It was kind of the first thing that we did together, so we had a little bit of practice working together on something that had like a common, very concrete goal, and then that those partners felt success out of that experience and decided that there was more that they could do together. And then we've been pretty intentional about the ways that that we've grown the partnership. We really worked on solidifying that group before we started reaching out to additional partners. And then, you know, now I would say there's about 300 groups that we work with in different configurations. And we can talk afterwards about what that looks like. But it was slow, it was intentional. And we had to really be explicit about talking about power and privilege in a room, about talking about decision-making structures, about talking about accountability structures, about figuring out, you know, people who wanted to be there because they wanted to be thought partners versus people who wanted to be there because they wanted to be doing partners, right? I mean, it's all that collaborative management. I have a theory that I share often with my table, which is that unless everybody around the table is feeling really uncomfortable with one strategy that's being employed at any time, we're not using our partnership to the best of its abilities. So our grasstops partners should be feeling really a little bit stressed about what our grassroots partners are doing. And our grassroots partners should be feeling a little bit stressed by what our grasstops partners are doing. Because what we think is that it really requires that full range of civic dialogue and civic engagement to really create the kind of big structural change that we're trying to move. And there's also just a lot of conflict and fighting, right? And that's just, you know, that's part of my job, is to manage and help us move through that as a collaborative table. Let's see, I'm gonna go back, one more in the back and then I'll come back up to the front.
In involving communities, what we found here, and I found throughout my career, oh, they brought the bus there all along. You know, how do you get over that? Or they live in those places. We don't want them. You know, and it's very hard how do you get over that prejudice, if you will, about people who ride mass transit and who live in subsidized housing?
Great. The question was, people don't like poor people. What do we do about that? And it's a hard one to answer, right? I mean, again, you know, I think there's folks who just, you know, kind of are explicit about that as their framework. And I think in many cases, those just aren't the folks that we invite to the table, right? The folks that we invite to the table are the folks that are ready to get creative and think with us. And for the folks But there's a lot of folks that aren't saying those things explicitly, right? There's a lot of that just lives inside of people. And so we do a lot of work in our collaborative context just around our own internal equity and inclusiveness. So there's lots of conversations that we have together and lots of discussion about racism, lots of discussion about prejudice, lots of discussion about implicit bias, a lot of discussion about microaggression, right? I mean, kind of all of those things. Those are things that we talk about. And then what we really try from a community context to make sure of is that our communities are empowered to speak up and speak out for themselves so that when you're in a community meeting and you have somebody that is really NIMBY-ing it up, that there's all that other kind of silent three quarters of the community doesn't have to feel silent because they're supported and they're in this space and they have other allies that are strong allies of theirs helping support them using their voice. There's a question up here, yeah.
Yeah, I think you mentioned early on you did demonstration projects that informed policy. Did any of those projects happen before the TOD fund? And regardless of whether they did, can you maybe just describe one, how it happened, the partners that were brought together?
Yeah, I mean, I would say that, I mean, the TOD fund itself was a change that happened out of a specific project called the Jody Apartments. So it was a parcel that was on the west line, right at the border of Lakewood and Denver. It needed some pretty substantial renovation. It was getting ready to be lost. You know, the owner was just not ready to to do the renovations that it would be required to keep it in place, and was just ready to sell it to the highest bidder. And so it was kind of a mini example of folks coming in together, buying it, revamping it, preserving it, assembling land around it to try to get some other uses on it. We used that as the model to build the TOD fund. We also used it as the model to put a preservation ordinance into place in the city of Denver that allowed the city first right of refusal on properties, that allowed the city of Denver a greater notice period so that they could intervene when those kinds of things happened, that expanded the kinds of federal funds that would need to be in a property that would kick the city of Denver into action. And so so I would say that for us was kind of our first demonstration thing, you can do it, and you could do it even better if you had a policy and some resources behind it to be able to do this in all kinds of places. Yeah, that's what I was saying. One more? Who had the last burning question? Yeah.
Does the Denver Transportation Authority use any value capture to fund future transit projects off of TOD or anything related to that?
Does our transit agency do that? I don't think so.
Capitalizing on the TOD.
No. No, I was trying to think if there was a place that that would happen. We have been in, we talk a lot about joint development, and we talk a lot about that as a potential funding source, actually, on some of the other things that we're working on with them around fares and service routes. And so what I was pondering was whether we've seen that happen anywhere, and I don't think we have. All right.
All right, let's give it up.
Thank you so much, Desa. I mean, there's so much we learn through smart people like you, and it's really important to hear about your successes and some of the things that we can implement here in Southern Nevada, and it's great to learn from others' mistakes as well, so thank you for sharing those. I do want to make a couple last-minute announcements. So sunbeams have magically appeared on your tables, these bright yellow triangles. Again, as you may recall, I asked you to start thinking about what are the things we as Southern Nevada should be focusing on. We've heard a lot of really great ideas about inclusiveness and funding and equity, all of those things. We would love to hear your thoughts. Write those down. There should be Sharpies on your table as well. Take a sunbeam, put down your idea, and then what we're going to have you do is, before you leave today, there's a big blue poster in the back corner of the room. We want to take our sunshine and radiate outward. So please, there should be stickums on the back of your sunbeams. Feel free to write them down, and staff will help you affix those to the blue poster. The other thing, too, is we do have comment cards on the table. We'd love to hear your thoughts about how we can improve what we're doing, both in terms of what your thoughts are on today's events, future events, anything else that comes to mind. If you're interested in getting involved in Southern Nevada Strong, feel free to put that on your comment card as well. If you want more information about Southern Nevada Strong, or if you want to get involved, on your table there are also flyers, a little one-pager about Southern Nevada Strong. It has our website that you can find out more information. The last thing I want to say is, if you really enjoyed the conversation, we're actually continuing this dialogue later on this afternoon with our Southern Nevada Strong Steering Committee. That meeting is at 1:30 p.m., and so we have Councilwoman Deborah March, who is vice chair of that. We have Ken McDonald, Dr. Field, and Jocelyn Cousins are all on that steering committee, and so what we're going to try to do this afternoon is roll up our sleeves based on what we heard today, what we're going to hear from you on your sunbeams, and really start to strategize what we can do to kind of move the needle on transit-oriented development. Before we adjourn you, I'd like to bring up our general manager, Tina Quigley, one last time to say.
Yeah, I just want to say thank you again for everybody for coming and convening. And as you do the sunbeams, if you wouldn't mind, really be very specific and tangible in what you'd like to see us do next. We heard from Desa, there was a starting point. There was a tipping point at some time where a group of people like us actually started to take the next step, whether it was organizing groups, organizing conversations, assigning leadership roles to people, starting to organize how things are administered and managed. I want to
I want to move us towards that conversation as well. So your sunbeams, not just aspirational, inspirational stuff, but for reals, reals, what's the next step towards us making this start to happen here in Southern Nevada? So thanks. That's all.
All right. Thank you.
Thank you all.